Hey everyone, I am back with another update to the Minecraft Minopoly board. I've been a little busy, but I have managed to, in the time since I did the last update, get a couple things done. I promised that I would show off community chest, chance, and the jail system, and so that's what I'll do today, since all three of those sort of go hand in hand. Now, on the walls there, you may have noticed the giant display systems. Right now, they both read 4. That's pure coincidence. Those represent the number of cards that you need to take. So, if we hit the button... Right now, we're standing on community chest, by the way. Sorry about that. And so, as you can see on the display, it now reads 10, because I hit the button. So, we go into our treasure chest here. Yeah, our treasure chest. Well, it's like a treasure chest of adventure. And... there's a bunch of maps. Now, you may have guessed at this point what I'm doing with the maps. This would be number 10, because they're in order. And here's our card. Your redstone skills were required. Collect 25 gold for services. As simple as that. You'll notice that it reads map 10 at the top. However, that's not the number I care about. It's really the number in the corner on the right-hand side. And that refers to the actual map number. There are duplicates of each of these maps in every chest for, I gotta put that away, community chest, as well as for chance, and they all look a little different. So after you're done, you put the card back, obviously, so let's put that back, and I just hit 12, so let's take a look at what 12 is. This would be number 12. You found the lost curator's treasure. Collect 45 gold. Treasure, Lewis, treasure! That is indeed a reference. To what? I will let you decide. Although it should be pretty obvious. In addition, here is an example of a chess card. Creepers thought you had a mighty nice everything. And, you know, da-da-da-da-da-da-da. And, yeah. That's an so I have these in each and every chest. So, I think from there, I can show you, I can talk a little bit about how the machines work, so I'll see you underside. So here I am, under the map once again. Behind me is the dice rolling machine that I showed you in the first update. And right over here, we have the all of the wiring for community chest. You can see that there's three different areas that it runs off to, and then all goes into this area right here, because there are three community chest spaces above the map, and they all run into this machine right over here, which is the exact same as the dice roller. It's another punch card machine. It's the same principle, however, instead of I did not mix any of the order up like I did with the previous one with the dice roller. So as you can see, they're sort of in a row. And there's 14 outcomes. Monopoly cards tend to change, actually, from set to set, I've noticed. Some have a different number. Some have a little more, some have a little less. The version I was working off of actually had 16, but I accidentally miscounted, and so now I have 14. A little bit of a shame, but it's alright. I decided that I could continue anyway. 14 outcomes is still quite a bit. So, when one of these happens, as you can see, here's the glass block here, so it's currently this line is lit. It follows out its path, ignore the white wool for a moment, I know this all looks confusing, in fact I'm confused by my own wiring, and goes into this decoder. The decoder then travels up here, and we're still following, actually we're no longer following the same path, as you, we're now following the ones that are lit up, because those are the ones that control the numbers. Those numbers mean absolutely nothing down here, and that was just for my own organization. It comes back up here, and goes into the proper pistons. So here I am, underground, once again, and, alright, here's the next part of this. So, and rather than acting like a dice roller and giving you a random number, this machine actually cycles through each and every line, so 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, etc., in order, to act like a deck of cards. So once you get to the end line here, it starts over and goes through the cycle again, one by one. So, because that's how it's supposed to work in real Monopoly, is that, you know, once you've finished with your card, you put it on the bottom of the stack. Now, That means that rather than... I could have labeled all the numbers above 1, 2, 3, etc. But that would have looked very boring. So you land on chance, say, and it has a 5 up on the board. And why even bother pressing the button? You know you're going to get a 6. So rather than actually have it come out in a numerical order, I just randomize the numbers, even though they are still in an order. It gives the look of random, but there actually is no random here. However, if a player wanted to between games, they would be more than welcome to come down here and move the glass blocks around so that they could have a new shuffle order to the cards. It was just a simple way for me to do that without getting very complicated. And I decided that's what I like to do. Now, because it acts like a deck of cards, something interesting happens with... Here's a get-out-of-jail-free card, in fact. This is the chance one. Get-out-of-jail-free, this card can be captured until needed or sold. That part right there is actually... It causes a problem, whether you know it or not. And you may guess it by this point. And that's that if it goes in order, then whatever line, whichever one of these lines, controls get-out-of-jail-free, if a player gets the card, they get to keep it. So next time around, once you cycle through the deck of cards one more time, that card is no longer there. So if a player lands on if a player lands on that space, there we are, they no longer can get that get-out-of-jail-free card, even if that's the number that comes up. And then that means they have to hit the button one more time. So I set up a little system over here, which is the white wool. And now this part gets a little confusing, but I'll explain to you what I've done. Without necessarily being able to explain to you how to do it in this particular show. So this line right here actually is the get-out-of-jail-free line for community chess, and as you can see it goes off in two different directions. One direction causes the piston to extend, since it's an inverse, actually. So when the power's off, the piston pulls up, and it allows power through. And because it inverts, as you can see. So that's good. So when you get out of the get-out-of-jail-free option, you get the get-out-of-jail-free option. However, the next time around, the next line is actually right here. And what this path does is it travels into an RLS NOR latch and actually turns the capability of getting that line off. So it will not display the get-out-of-jail-free number if it has already been, if it has already been the outcome once in the map. Now, that isn't to say, and I hope I'm not being too confusing right now, that isn't to say that it turns off get-out-of-jail-free forever. It just turns off get-out-of-jail-free until it's reset. Before I get into that, I will just say that when get-out-of-jail-free is selected a second time in the map after the card has been taken by another player, all of this wiring right here travels along this path and tells the machine to press the button one more time, even though the player doesn't know it. So it will display a number. It doesn't display a blank screen. It just goes to the next number, and the player's none the wiser. So that part's pretty cool. The reset actually is this RLS NOR latch. When the reset right here, here's a button. However, that's not actually what will do the resetting in the actual game. This line right here is actually responsible for it. When the line is reset, that means that the card has been put back in the chest, probably by the player, because it's been used. And now it opens the line up again, so the next time Get Out of Jail Free would come up, it comes up. That's how all this works down here. And it took me quite a bit of time to actually get that all to work, but now it works really well, so I'm pretty proud of it. How does it get reset? Well, that's all part of going to jail, which is the next part I will show you. So anyone who's played Monopoly before will tell you that there are a number of ways to end up in jail. This is true, and this is one of them right here, the go-to-jail square. And I will show you how this works. If you land on this square, you'll notice there's no roll for this, and there's a good reason for that, because you're going to jail. You're coming down here, where you will find an expectant minecart. This minecart, thanks to the system I've set up, will always be waiting for you, and is ready to take you to jail. with the press of a button. Don't you feel so lucky? Now, I want to say one thing as I'm going to jail, and that's that if it acts like a deck of cards, and so it goes one after another, and it's in a chest, why did I need the giant display system? Why not just put it back in the chest and move all the maps or whatever I'm using? And I could have done that, but I was trying to minimize what the player had to do during the game. So that is why I chose this system, and I like it. So there you go. When you get to here, you have to go through this door, and this pressure plate sends the minecart all the way back to the reset point, which is why it will always be waiting there to take you to jail. Follow the stairs up, and we're in jail now. Nice and safe behind iron bars. The bars still give the player a wide view of the map, so they can see where other players are, they can see the board, and they know when it's their turn. Here's the roll button. It works, obviously, and it controls the dice. And here are the buttons for getting out of jail. Each button can control the door and open it, obviously. And here are the buttons for get out of free jail cards. Now, I've actually changed my mind rather recently about how this all works, and I've decided now that each chest, Chance of Commune chest, will have several get-out-of-jail-free cards. There will be one in the proper place, and then several all down the bottom line. The reason I've decided this is because when a player uses their get-out-of-jail-free card, let's say we hit the button right, because we have our get-out-of-jail-free card right here, they'll just place it in this chest, and to reset it, the person with the map can either just, you know, wipe it and reload the map, re-download the map, or they can come in here, get the cards, and put them back in the proper chest after the game. That way it doesn't take time out of the player, you know, out of the player's move. Because when they get out of jail, who knows how long they've been holding onto the card for? Will they remember which chest it came from? Will they have to go through to every single chest just to put a single card back? And, you know, slow down the game that way. So instead, they'll just put the card in the chest, hit the proper button, door opens, they're out of jail forever, hooray, or until they land back in jail, they don't go this way, they go that way. And the game can continue on, and there will be more get-out-of-jail-free cards in the chest when the number comes up for the other players. So that is how I'll do it. And that is what I've decided I like. So, were the display boards completely necessary originally? No. But do they add a lot of fun to the game? Yes. Oh, and I forgot to mention, while I was in jail, that each of those buttons for Chance and Community Chest also reset the RLS neural latches all the way underground and allow the numbers to come up again. Yeah, that's what they do. So, there's the update for Jail, Chance, and Community Chest. I actually have been working on a lot of other areas. In fact, I've had Hank from AMHRcraft help me out a lot as well. So, it's coming along rather nicely. And maybe next update, I'll show you some more of the areas without giving too much away. So, thank you all for watching. Have a good one.